Hey there, everyone. Welcome to an exclusive conversation about a new CNN film, The Price of Freedom. I'm Laura Jarrett, co-host of Early Start on CNN, and I'm absolutely thrilled to be here today with a filmmaker, a producer, Judd Ehrlich, who has given us a wonderful chance to get a behind the sneak peek into The Price of Freedom and talk to us about the filmmaking process. Judd, so nice to see you today. Thanks so much for doing this.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
So watching the film, it's terrific. One of the things that I found so challenging and frustrating about watching it is being reminded of how many times in our history we've been at something of a crossroads when it comes to actually doing something about gun violence, and how at each of those inflection points, if you will, it seemed as though nothing changed. So tell me, I have to imagine that's a hard story to tell. So how did this all come about?
You're right. I mean, it's incredibly frustrating. And it was frustrating to relive it all in the making of the film. And that was really the question that I began with. How did we get here? How did we get to a place in America where gun violence is so prevalent, where there's so many guns in our society, and yet so few gun laws? And the American people want some type of regulation, both gun owners and non-gun owners alike, Republicans and Democrats. And yet we don't have that kind of regulation in this country. And when you dug just a little bit deeper, all of those roads led to the NRA. And that's really where this began.
And how did you get people to open up and talk to you for this film? Because in watching it, it struck me, Gabby Giffords, Lucy McBath, all these people who've been so deeply and personally affected by gun violence in their lives, who I imagine, you know, even the some of the moms from Parkland and Sandy Hook, I imagine they have to feel at this point a little bit tired in still having the same conversation. How did you get people to open up to you?
I think, yes, people are tired, but I take hope and strength from people like Gabby Giffords, survivors who go out every day and continue to fight for gun reform and gun safety and gun laws in this country that could help save lives. And that's what gives me hope and strength. I mean, you're right. We have an incredible cast in this film, people who were willing to participate, everybody from President Clinton and Representative McBath, you mentioned, to the other side. People like David Keene, who is a current board member and former president of the NRA. And I think on all sides, people wanted to tell their story, to make their case. And I think in all cases, we wanted to give people the space and the room to make their argument, to make their case for what they believe. And I think what emerges, what I hope emerges, are different visions for this country. And the NRA's vision is a very radical agenda that very few Americans, I think, believe in. And yet they've been able to dominate the conversation in this country for decades. And that needs to stop.
I was interested to see Keene in the film, obviously, given, you know, his power and his influence. Have you received any pushback from the NRA? It's a pretty unflinching look at a pretty powerful group that I think is, you know, a pretty clear-eyed view of their influence in this whole situation.
The answer is not yet. I'm curious to see how they respond to the broadcast with CNN and CNN Films. I'm thrilled that it's getting out to a wider audience, and my hope is that it becomes a spark to have a deeper and different conversation about guns in this country. And my hope is that by peeling back the layers of this history and understanding that this is relatively recent history, that the NRA really changed the course of this country when Harlan Carter took over the organization in 1977 in a coup in Cincinnati. And it didn't have to be this way. So at once, the fact that it didn't have to be this way is sad and frustrating, but it also is hopeful in that there's a history of gun reform and gun laws in this country dating back to our founding.
Yeah.
And even with the NRA itself, the NRA used to be for almost a century about marksmanship, about the shooting sports, about hunting, about conservation, about positive aspects of gun culture, before they turned into a really radical organization that did everything they could to associate firearms with this notion of what it means to be free, what it means to be American, what it means to have personal liberty in this country. Mm. And it doesn't need, firearms don't need to be associated with those things. And most firearm owners don't associate them so strongly with that. But it's been part of the success of the NRA that they've been able to push that narrative and really plug into that strain of American culture over those decades.
So that was one of the things, in just thinking through about American culture, one of the really smart moves I think you made in the film is to sort of trace back that history going way, way back to even, you know, our earliest founding, and sort of exposing all of the different laws that different states and territories had passed, you know, obviously so, so long ago, to show that this was actually part of the idea of what things were supposed to look back. How much of our history did you know going into making this film? Because I have to tell you, like, I went to law school and I learned a lot of it from this film about just our gun laws and how things sort of developed again in each of the states. Were those things that you sort of knew coming into the film? How did that process work?
I mean, so much of the film was revelatory to me, and I hope to audiences and people like yourself watching it. You know, there is really a pervasive myth in this country that I think the NRA has successfully pushed over decades, that the natural state of affairs at the founding and for hundreds of years was that there was no regulation, that that everybody should have a firearm in an unregulated environment. And that's just not the case. And that is, in fact, a myth about this country. So when you start to dig a little deeper and understand that, other myths that the NRA has perpetrated over the years begin to unravel. And I think that's why it's so powerful to look into the history of this country and look into the history of the organization.
And what were some of the obstacles in making this? Obviously, I imagine you're doing it during COVID. I don't know when you started the filmmaking process, but I noted that at least some of the people were wearing masks in some of the scenes and then taking them off. So, I know that COVID has presented a lot of challenges for us who are trying to produce content out there. So what was that process like?
We filmed this entirely during the pandemic, and we had an amazing crew that put it together. And of course, our subjects were incredible to be willing to participate during the pandemic. We, of course, took every COVID precaution while filming. I did most of the interviews remotely over Zoom, and we had small local crews, which actually allowed us to film many more interviews in a faster time frame, because we were able to shoot all over the country. But I think the pandemic, you talked about how many people participated in this film, and we got, you know, so many yeses when we asked, will you participate? I think that part of that was because the pandemic was going on and everybody was living through it, and issues with firearms were coming to the fore. We saw sales increasing of firearms. We saw some of the same things that we talk about in the film with the 1960s, where you have groups asserting their rights as Americans. So you have in the 1960s, the civil rights movement, and you have in the summer of 2020, Black Lives Matter. And when that happens on the other side, you have a backlash. And we saw that in the summer of 2020. We saw Kyle Rittenhouse. We saw people taking arms into state houses. We saw plots against governors. We saw all of this, and we were all living it. And I think that people felt a desire on all sides to speak out about it during the pandemic. So I think there was a sense of urgency about making this film and the relevance of this film at the moment we were making it.
So what would you say to perhaps a potential viewer who says, you know, Judd, I'm already in favor of stricter gun control in this country. I already agree with you that gun violence is a problem. What would you say to somebody about what maybe perhaps the biggest takeaway you hope people will get from this film?
It's a great question. You know, President Clinton talks about this in the film. And it's really his lesson that he'd learned from the midterms. And he says that opinion polls don't matter. That what matters is who gets out there and votes. And it's very simple. And, you know, I think embedded in your question is that we all know people who are willing to voice their opinions and believe strongly in ideals and may believe strongly in gun control. But the reality is, if you don't do something about it, it doesn't matter. So if you don't vote, it doesn't matter. If you don't get out there in your community, it doesn't matter. If you don't go and call your congressperson and go to your elected officials, it doesn't matter. So what I want people to take from this film is that if you care about these issues, get out there and do something. And I think what offers a little bit of hope again, and I think we're all looking for hope now, is the midterms in 2018 and seeing the way the gun safety, gun reform movement, and it really became a movement after Parkland, took a page from the NRA and said, look, we have to elect people. We have to go out there and elect people on an explicitly gun safety platform if we want things to change in this country. And they did. And they went out there and they made it happen. And there were something like 40 people who came into office that year, Lucy McBath among them, who ran on the gun issue. And it became a badge of honor that the NRA gave these representatives an F. Not something to run away from. So the conversation is beginning to change, but people need to be vigilant. People need to stay on this. And I think David Keene warns us and warns the audience at the end of the film, and it was important for me to have that in there, that the NRA is not going to go away. And even with their legal trouble, don't count them out. But what he says after that, I think, is particularly telling, and folks should pay attention to it, that even if the NRA were to end tomorrow, there are so many folks out there that when this bell is rung, that this slippery slope bell, that your Second Amendment rights are going to be taken away from you if any type of gun reform, no matter how benign, is passed. Folks are going to come out and do what they need to do to make sure that no gun reform is passed. And so if you believe in gun reform, you need to come out on the other side. You need to answer that. I do want people to take that away from this film.
Well, it's certainly a conversation that is here and now. And I think that you are an important voice in this conversation, in this debate, and this film certainly adds to the canon in that discussion in a really important and enlightening and engaging way. I think, as you said, one of the biggest takeaways for me was that engagement piece of it and feeling that everybody is a part of engagement as citizen number one. So Judd Ehrlich, thank you so much for sitting down with me to chat about this. It's a terrific film. I encourage everyone to check it out. It's again, The Price of Freedom, CNN film. It's gonna premiere on Sunday, August 29th at 9 p.m. at CNN, only on CNN. I'm Laura Jarrett. Thank you so much for joining us.